Jesus, while you're walking on the water, won't you walk on out to me? Walk on the water, walk on the raging sea. Sweet Jesus, while you're walking on the water, won't you walk on out to me?
Lord, there never was a soul who needed you like I need you today. My strength is gone, my heart is sore. Won't you meet me just halfway?
Tell me to walk,
walk on the water, walk on the raging sea. Sweet Jesus, while you're walking on the water, won't you walk on out to me?
Can't you see I'm using every bit of strength and weakness just to stand? Won't you walk on out a little farther, please, Jesus, take me by the hand.
Walk on the water, walk on the raging sea. Sweet Jesus, while you're walking on the water, won't you walk on out to me? Oh, oh, walk on the water, on the raging sea. Sweet Jesus, walk on out to me.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King.
The faithful, the brave are here early this morning, slip sliding into church. Well, welcome to Westside on this beautiful, tropical, warm Sunday morning. So glad that you're here. We're going to have to sing doubly loud this morning, all right? Let's everybody stand and sing this morning about the greatness, the faithfulness of our God for all that He's done for us. Let's sing about that. praise the Lord this morning for his faithfulness. We serve a great God, amen? What a faithful God. For all that God has done this morning, we can praise him and bless him and lift up his name through the wonderful gift of music. Let's sing together this great old hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. May be seated.
Amen.
In Revelation 4, it talks about the glory of heaven. In the center and around the throne were four living beings, each covered with eyes, front and back. The first of these living beings was like a lion, the second was like an ox, and the third had a human face, and the fourth was like an eagle in flight. And each of these living beings had six wings, and their wings were covered all over with eyes, inside and out. And day and night after night, they kept on saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, the one who always was, who is, and who is still to come. This morning, we're going to continue that same song of heaven this morning, what they're singing around the throne in heaven, that God is holy, not just holy, but holy, holy, Holy is the Lord God Almighty. We're going to sing with heaven this morning. Continue that theme of holiness. You are holy, Lord. We bless you, Jesus.
You are holy, holy. Lord, there is none like you.
There.
lift your voices, sing it out.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This morning, what they're singing in your presence, you are holy. God, we bless you this morning. We bless you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for bringing us here safely this morning. I pray for those standing here this morning that are hurting and broken, those that came in with a deep hurt and a deep need, Lord, maybe even too deep to share. I pray your presence, your sweet presence, would surround them and bless them, Lord. Be their peace speaker, whatever it is they're going through, Lord. We just pause to say thank you, Jesus, for your greatness, for your faithfulness. You are holy, God. We bless you this morning. We bless you, Jesus. In your powerful name, Lord, I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. What a blessing it is to be able to worship together. And even on this cold day, and some of us maybe want to sleep in and avoid all that, you're here and God is here and God is blessing you. And so we're thankful for that. We're excited that you're with us this morning. At this time, we're going to dismiss our kids up through sixth grade. And you can go ahead over with Pastor Nate over there by the kids sign. He's got a great day planned for you guys. And as they're heading over, ushers, you can come forward as we prepare for our tithes and our offerings. If you're a guest with us today, we just want to say welcome. And we're especially glad that you're here. There's a connection card in the pew rack in front of you. Go ahead and fill that out for us. And you can drop it in the boxes in the back of the worship center afterwards as we are able to follow up and connect with you as best we can. Just a couple things that we want to highlight for you all here this morning. There's a bunch of things going on all the time, but just a few that we want to make sure you're aware of and a couple of dates to put on your calendar. The first one, February 4th is our next combined all-church service at 10 a.m. So that's 3 weeks from today, February 4th. It's going to be a great service, and we're excited for it already of what God is going to do. But then afterwards is Super Sunday. And if you got a bulletin, there's more information in that for you, but we're going to have kind of an all-church soup and chili cook-off. It's going to be great, and I'm excited for it personally, and it's going to be an awesome time. So we hope you put that on your calendar, put it on your radar, and it's going to be a great morning. Then the next week, February 11th, is a new membership class. If that's something that you've never done, maybe you're interested in hearing more about, there's information to RSVP in the bulletin as well, or you can talk to Pastor Tony after the service. He'll be able to answer any questions for you. Just a great opportunity if maybe that's your next step of how to get more plugged in here at Westside. That'll be February 11th coming up soon. Would you pray with me as we continue in worship today? And God, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for each person here. Lord, I just pray a blessing over each one of us. I pray that you would bless our offerings and our tithes as we just give back to what you've done for us and you're continuing to do in us. God, be with us today. Be with us this week. We love you. Amen. ¶¶
harvest fields now ripened, there's a work for all to do. Hark, the Master's voice is calling to the harvest, calling you.
Does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little? It is great if God is in it, and He won't forsake.
Has ended, and your race on earth is run. He will say, if you've been faithful, well, come home, my child.
I'm Pastor Dave. It's good to be with you. Everybody doing all right? Got your coffee keeping warm? It's kind of chilly out there. It's good to be with you. We're continuing in our series today on the 12 disciples, the first 12 followers of Jesus. Began this last week with Matthew. We're going to continue on all the way up through Easter, one disciple per week, all the way up to Easter, and learning about the disciples. Now, let me remind you what this series is about. It is about the disciples. We're going to study their life, some stories about them, where they ministered, how they were martyred, various things. But ultimately, this series is really about two other things. Number one, it's about Jesus. Amen? Everything's about Jesus. So it's the disciples pointing us to Jesus. And the series is also to help you become a better disciple. So if you come to all 12 weeks of these, or even a fraction of them, and you're just learning about the disciples, you're missing the point. It's how we can be better disciples of Jesus. Let me remind you their 12 names. I don't know that I'll do this every week, but just to show you these. Peter, James, John, Andrew, he's today. We'll talk about him in a minute. Bartholomew, which is Nathaniel, James the Lesser, Judas, Jude, who's also called Thaddeus, Matthew, that was last week, Philip, Simon, and Thomas. A weird team. Evidently, God loves weird teams. Amen? Okay, He does, I promise you. This is a weird team. There are blue-collar guys, white-collar guys here. There are city guys. There are country guys. There are tall guys. There are short guys. There are old guys. There are young guys. It's a weird team. If you're on a team, or a church specifically, a religion that everybody thinks the same, talks the same, watches the same TV shows, goes to the same restaurants, uses the same colloquialisms, does all the same stuff, you're probably in a cult, just so you know. Because God's teams are distinct in a variety of people from all kinds of walks of life and all kinds of places. But today, I want to talk to you about Andrew, okay? He's this guy. I know it's hard to see because the drum cage for you guys over there, but is what it is. Andrew, he's the third from the left there. This painting, by the way, Da Vinci's Last Supper was painted in 1495. And the scene he's painting here is Jesus has just said to his disciples, one of you will betray me. And all of the reactions are based on that. And you can see Andrew, he's kind of doing like this, whoa, hold on, I don't agree with this. It's not me. I'm not betraying anybody. You can see that surprised posture he has. So that's his take. Again, the disciples had no idea what was going to take place until after the death and resurrection of Jesus. Then they kind of put it together, but this is a part of their reaction. Let me tell you a little bit about Andrew. Let's walk through some things with him. Go to my next slide there, would you please? So here's Andrew. Let me tell you a few things about him. We're going to learn more throughout the day, but let me give you this brief biography before we talk about him. He's from Galilee. We believe he was born around the year 6 A.D., and we believe Jesus was born around the year 4 A.D., so he was maybe a couple years older than Jesus, contemporary, born in Galilee. His brother was Simon. Now, Simon's name was changed to Peter. That's the main disciple. He's the main, Jesus' main leader of the disciples. He's the alpha male of them all. But interestingly enough, before Peter was Peter, he grew up as Simon. So it's Simon and Andrew were brothers. There's an interesting insight into their family here. Simon is a Hebrew name. Andrew is a Greek name. That's going to come to play in a little bit, but the little insight there is we just wonder about their family, that they were trying to bridge cultural gaps or be that those kind of people. Who knows what they were like, but they were brothers. Now, all of Jesus' disciples mattered, but they didn't all get the same press in the Bible. Peter is mentioned 189 times. His brother Andrew, 13. So he always kind of lived in the shadow of Peter, perhaps. He's the younger brother of the two. And most of the time in the Bible, he's actually referred to, when they don't use his name, as Peter's brother. So that's who he is. I think that might come into play in a little bit. Now, he was a part of the inner four. Let me tell you what that is. Jesus had 12 disciples. Three of them were his inner group, Peter, James, and John. But Andrew was also closely linked to them. There are a lot of occasions where Jesus had just those three and even a fourth guy. Andrew tagged along some of the times. Not all of the time, but some of the time. So he's kind of in the closer group to Jesus that Jesus was spending more time with, but he wasn't part of the big three, but the inner four. He was a fisherman. We knew that. He and Peter and James and John, they were fishermen. Probably that was their livelihood. We talked about that last week. Golf. There's a famous golf course, one of the most famous golf courses in all the world. It's in Scotland. Here it is, St. Andrew's Golf Course, named after Andrew. Here's the idea. It's right off St. Andrew's Bay in Scotland. Years and years and years ago, centuries ago, they were sending relics of Andrew. Now, what this is part of his body, his bones that had decomposed, and part of his material possessions. They wanted to send them to the ends of the earth to protect them. The Catholic Church did. So they sent one of their leaders out, go to the end of the world, and he crashed in Scotland in a little town that now is called St. Andrew's Bay, and that's how he got associated with Scotland. We'll come back to that in a little bit. He's also, did you know that this form of tie, the knot, you know what that's called? St. Andrew's knot. I kid you not. Come on, that's all right. Some of you are wearing that today. That's St. Andrew's knot. That's I don't know why he got associated with that, but there you go. And he's called the bringer. He is called the bringer because there are three stories about him. Three stories, and all three, he brings somebody to Jesus. Now, here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at all three of these stories today and learn about him. But the idea of the bringer, I think about it this way. You know, Jesus calls the church a body. He uses illustration for the church globally as a body, because we're a family, or, you know, a one organism working together. And a local church like us, God would say, is a body. There are some people who are the head, who do the thinking for the group, some do the speaking, some do the walking, some are the hands that do the work. It's just a metaphor. I think if in that metaphor, Andrew would be a ligament. Ligaments in your body. They connect bone to bone. Ligaments in the church of God, the body of Christ, they connect people to each other. And that's what Andrew does. We're going to see that in three stories. We'll look at all three of them kind of briefly, and we'll learn about being a disciple. So let's start with his calling. It's in John chapter 1. And by the way, all of his stories are in John. The next day, John, now that's John the Baptist, just so we're clear, John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin. He was not a disciple of Jesus. He was the last of all the prophets. He was a great man, John the Baptist. He was there with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying? Come and see," Jesus said. So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 p.m. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, there he is, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," and he brought him, Peter that is, to Jesus. Let's just run this a little bit and learn some stuff about Andrew, about being a disciple. First of all, John the Baptist, that's who we're talking about here. John the Baptist also had disciples. Jesus had disciples. And we learned last week about the scribes, who they had disciples. They were often called Pharisees. So teachers would have disciples that would follow them. And in that day and age, people would find a scribe that was elite or the best they could find, and they would follow him. And oftentimes, the more clout that your leader had, the more clout that you carried. John the Baptist had no clout culturally. He was a weird dude. He ate locusts. He wore camel's clothes. He lived in the wilderness. He's a little bit of a freak. And so that's who these guys are following. But they are in search of truth, okay? Now, last week we learned that some people are like Matthew. Matthew was not looking for Jesus at all. Matthew was sitting at his tax collector's booth, and Jesus found him. But some people are like Andrew, searching for truth, looking for truth, and everywhere they can, and that's the story of him. So he's following John the Baptist, along with another guy. We believe this other guy, even though he's not named, we believe it's John, because that's how John writes the book here. John the Baptist says to these two guys, when Jesus walks by, he says, "Look," he's teaching, "look, that guy, that's the Lamb of God." So John the Baptist tells them who Jesus really is. He gives his identity. And John the Baptist is the first to get it. He's the first to understand who Jesus is and what he's all about. He's the first one to look at his cousin Jesus. They're cousins. And he says, "That guy, that's God. That's who we want to learn from. That's who we want to follow. That's who we want to worship." Now, this Lamb of God thing, here's how this worked. I think I've told you about it before, but let me recap. Before Jesus, the system for atonement or forgiveness was found in sacrifices. So the people would come at this time of Passover to the city of Jerusalem, and they would go to the temple. And at the temple, they would buy certain animals that had no spot or blemish on them, like doves or pigeons or sheep if you're richer, that sort of thing. And you would tell you would give a confession to the priest of your sins, and they would put those sins like on the animal, and then they would carry the animal. You couldn't go with them, but they would carry the animal into the inner room of the temple. It's called the Holy of Holies, where the high priest was. And in that room, there was a chair. It was called the mercy seat. And they would put that animal on there, and they would slaughter it. They would kill it. They would cut its throat. All the blood would drain out. And they had this like gutter system that would flow out of the Holy of Holies, and all the blood would be washed away. And if you were outside, you could see these sacrifices happening and know that that lamb was slaughtered. And if you brought that lamb, that's how you were forgiven. That's the system of atonement for them. So what John is saying is Jesus is the lamb that's going to be sacrificed, meaning two things. Number one, he's going to be slaughtered. And that is exactly what happened to Jesus. They didn't put him to death like easily or without pain or gently. They slaughtered him. They flayed him wide open. It was a terrible thing. And he literally was done that. His blood ran everywhere, just like on the mercy seat. And secondly, he says that's the Lamb of God for the whole world is what he's indicating here. That Jesus' sacrifice would be for everyone, not just Jews, but everyone. He's saying, if you want to be saved, he's two disciples, you guys want to be saved? That's where you find salvation. In Jesus, that's who he's pointing. You need his blood to be shed for you. You need his forgiveness. You need Jesus. So Andrew, and John, but Andrew's who are focused today, they leave John the Baptist. Now, he's what's called an early adopter, somebody who believes in this first. He's an early adopter. He's actually called the protoclete. You know what that means? It means the first called. He's the first disciple of Jesus, the first one called to be a disciple of Jesus. He has that honor for all history. So at this point in their life, they only know one thing about Jesus, as far as we can tell. That's what John the Baptist said. You and I know way more about Jesus right now than he knew at that moment. He knew very little. We know everything. We know Jesus' life and ministry, his death, his resurrection. But at that point in time, all he knew is what John the Baptist had said to him. So why did they leave their teacher, John the Baptist, to follow Jesus? It's because they trusted their teacher. They trusted John the Baptist. They had spent time with John the Baptist. Even though the world viewed him as a freak, they knew he was the real deal, and they trusted in what he said. He won't lie to us is what I think is going through their mind. Now, think about that for us. We don't usually make purchases or spend money on events or activities based on marketing. Maybe you do, but I think marketing that's shoved into our face is largely a humongous failure. What typically convinces you to buy something or do something is when a friend says, hey, you got to try this. A trusted friend says, you got to go here. You got to eat at this restaurant. You got to do this. And you think, yeah, we'll give that a shot because a trusted friend has told you about it. That's the best marketing. And that's what's happening here. A trusted friend has told them Jesus. John the Baptist is connecting them. Jesus is who you need. So many of us have probably had somebody in our life that told us about Jesus. Andrew's had that same experience. Somebody told him about Jesus. And I wonder if that impacted him so much that that's why he spent his life telling other people about Jesus. That's why he's the connector, always bringing people to Jesus, because someone did that to him. Now think about this. This takes a lot of humility for John the Baptist. He just gave away a bunch of his class. Hey, go follow that guy. Go follow him. He's way better than I am. And that's what happened. The mark of a disciple. We learned it last week. We're going to learn it again right now. We may learn it every week, is abandonment. The mark of a disciple is abandonment. One of the marks. Andrew abandons John the Baptist to follow Jesus. If we follow Jesus, there will be things in our life that we need to abandon. If you're a follower of Jesus and haven't abandoned anything in your life, you might need to question, am I really following Jesus? Because it comes hand in hand. We'll see it all the time. Now, I don't mean abandonment in the bad sense. Jesus won't ask you to abandon your wife or your husband or your kids or your church. Not the bad sense. But there is an abandonment that there are things that are in our life that will stop us from following God. We got to abandon those things. Or there are things in our life that aren't reflective of somebody who does follow God. There are language that we need to abandon, hobbies that we need to abandon, pursuits, goals, dreams that we need to abandon. There's all kinds of stuff that will come with being a disciple. There is an abandonment. When we follow Jesus, we're leaving something behind, an old way of life, old desires, maybe old friends, old pursuits. It comes hand in hand with abandonment. In this series, I think you should ask every week, what do I need to abandon for Jesus? What does Jesus ask me to leave behind? Because here's what happens. When you leave something behind, you get something new from Jesus. Amen, church? And God's plans are to prosper you and not to harm you. They're always good. There's a letting go and a grabbing on to new things. That's what happens here. So back to our scripture there. And Jesus sees them following him, and he says, what do you want? So they're like stalking Jesus. They're like following Jesus. He turns around like, what do you guys want? Now, he's not confused here. Jesus is kind of setting them up. He, why are you following me? Now, by the way, I think that's a great question to ask ourselves all the time, maybe even right now. Why are you following Jesus? Why are you here today? Why are you in church today? What are you doing here? Are you here because it's the thing you do? There's a greater reason. Are you here because you just wanted to hear about Andrew? There's greater things. Why are you here today? I think the best answer for that is to know who Jesus is. That's why we want to be following Jesus. Now, notice Jesus doesn't say, who are you looking for? He says, you know, what do you want? In other words, Jesus knows that they want something to happen in their hearts. And they say, Rabbi, where are you staying? That's an interesting thing. Where are you staying? Okay, what's your deal? Now, first of all, they call him rabbi, which means teacher. They say, they're basically saying, we want you to be our teacher. We want to ditch John the Baptist. He's a great guy. We love him. But he says, we should follow you. So we want you to be our teacher. At this point in his life, I mean, that's, if you just stop right there, all that Andrew knows about Jesus is that he's a good teacher. Let's follow this guy and learn about him. He just calls him teacher. And to some Christians, maybe even some in this room, that's all Jesus is to you, a good teacher. You hear, we're studying about Andrew today. Let's go hear about Andrew. Let's see hear some teaching about Andrew. Maybe Jesus, all to you, is just a teacher. What a lame thing. It's a lame thing that for you to just let Jesus be just your teacher when he's so much greater. Now, the word here that's used is, I think it's a little bit of a translation kind of conundrum. The word here is meno, M-E-N-O. And it's really the word abiding, not staying, like where are you sleeping, where do you live? It's where are you abiding? Jesus uses the same word in John 15 where he says, if you abide in me, you will bear much fruit. They're saying, we want to know who the center of you is. Where are you living? John the Baptist says you're the Lamb of God. We want to know about you and where you're like centered and where you're focused. I think that's a little bit better understanding of what they're asking here. And Jesus says, come and see. Now, those are important words. Don't forget those. We'll come back to that. Come and see. Oftentimes, the first words that Jesus says to a disciple are so important, and that one is like the others. So Jesus welcomes investigation. You want to know who I am? You want to know what my heart beats for? Come and see. The beauty is, you know what he says? He doesn't say, you just want me for a teacher. Get out of here. He doesn't say that. He's not mad at that. He knows that he can do more for them, but he welcomes them. Come and see. We'll take this journey together. And they spend the day with Jesus. Now, it tells us it's about the 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Your version might say something, but it's 10th hour, but it's about 4 in the afternoon. Here's my point. Who cares? Why do we care that it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon? What does that have to do with anything? I think it has something to do with this, perhaps. Now, 4 o'clock in the afternoon was much later than 4 o'clock for us, meaning this. They didn't have modern technology. They didn't have lights or electricity. They went to bed way, way earlier than we do, and they got up way, way earlier than we did. So by the time 4 o'clock comes, that might be more like 8 o'clock for us, and it's dinner time is the point. It's dinner time, and they spend time with Jesus, and they have dinner. And it's fascinating to me to read between the lines here that everything started at a dinner table. It all started with Andrew and the other disciples sitting with Jesus over dinner. This movement is global wide. There are over 1 billion people who call themselves Christian, and it all started with 2 guys at dinner with Jesus 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I can think about Andrew. Maybe the moment he's crucified, when they kill him, I'll tell you about that in a minute, that I wonder if he's thinking this all began at dinner over chicken. I wonder, you know? Special things happen at dinner. Yeah. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother. Now, there's a play on words here that you can't really see unless you look at it. Jesus says, what are you looking for? Like, why are you looking? Why are you following me? What are you looking for? And then he goes to Peter and he says, we have found the Messiah. It's a seeking and finding imagery that you'll find all throughout the Bible, and it's only found in Jesus. So I asked you earlier, what are you here for? You're here for answers. You're here for truth. You're here for worship. You only find that in Jesus. And the interesting thing is he's found the Messiah. That's a quick change here. You spend time with Jesus, here's what happens. He changes from a rabbi to the Messiah. That's what happened. He's calling him teacher here, but after a day, after time with him, after this is his spiritual encounter. This is his salvation moment that Jesus becomes his Messiah, the Lord of his life. We know that to be true. And the first thing he does is he goes and finds his brother, Simon, and brings him to Jesus. Now, Peter starts off as Simon, but God changes his name to Peter, and he's a fisherman. Now, you can picture the conversation here, right? Peter's at the nets, and he's fishing, and Andrew comes. We found it. We've all been looking for this guy. We found him. John the Baptist told him about it. We had dinner with him. This guy's great. You got to come meet him. I got to connect you with Jesus. You can picture that scene. Now, Peter will become the head of the church. He will. He's the alpha male, he's the leader of the group, the head of the church, and it all began when his brother invited him to Jesus. Andrew has only known Jesus for a couple hours, and already he's convinced, and already he's the first disciple to bring somebody to Jesus. Now, let me give you a little point here about discipleship. I think this, discipleship begins at home. begins right at home. Yes, we want our neighbors to know Jesus. We want our coworkers to know Jesus. We want everybody to know Jesus. Absolutely. But it begins at home. It begins at home. I don't think Jesus wants us to, actually, I know this, that Jesus doesn't want us to be sharing the gospel with everybody we meet and on the corners of the streets handing out tracts, but ignoring our family. That's important. Parents leading our kids to Jesus. Spouses helping each other grow closer to Jesus. Leading family to Jesus. I'll tell you an interesting story. Just yesterday, a little bit sudden, a little bit not sudden, Steve Rice's father passed away in Kentucky. He happened to be with him. They had a surgery. It didn't go well, and he passed away on the operating table. His father was an unchurched person until 2 weeks ago. Steve led him to Jesus. Isn't that fantastic? Discipleship begins at home. If Steve hadn't have done that, his father would have faced eternity today, yesterday without the Lord. Discipleship begins at home. That's the first thing Andrew did. Now let's look at a second story, and these other stories are a little bit quicker here. But let me read it to you. This is the feeding of the 5,000. You know that story? Jesus feeds 5,000 people with a couple loaves and fishes. Andrew is integral. Let me read it to you, and then we'll learn a couple things. So Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee. That's where Andrew's home was. Andrew's born in Galilee. They're there in Galilee. I wonder if he knew a lot of people there that day. Probably some. And a great crowd of people followed him. A lot of people. Not a few. A lot of people. Because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. So they're there because of what Jesus has done. He's healed sick people, and everybody likes to be healed. Again, just like Peter, or like Andrew first called Jesus teacher, but Jesus wanted to be more than that. These people are following Jesus because he's a healer, but he can be more than that too. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. When Jesus saw a great crowd coming towards him, he said to Philip, I mean, they're watching this whole, there's a lot of people, it's the middle of the day, food is going to be a part here, and Jesus says to Philip, where should we buy bread for these people to eat? He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, well, it would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Andrew speaks up. Here's a boy with five small barley loaves and two fish, but how far will they go among so many? And you know the rest of the story, that Jesus takes the fish and the bread and breaks it and prays and breaks it, does a miraculous thing and feeds everybody in that great crowd, 5,000 plus, a lot of people, the Bible tells us, many, many people. So Jesus had a plan. So all these people, Jesus has a plan internally, but he doesn't tell the disciples. He tests them first, okay? You will have tests as a disciple. They will come. We're going to talk about that more when we get to Philip, because Philip's the guy who constantly gets tested. You've heard of the SAT? Disciples, you get the G-O-D. That test comes. And this is what's happening in this story. Now, we'll look at that more when we get to Philip, but a couple things. He goes to Philip first because he knows the character of Philip. And Philip's this thinking mind. He's an analytical kind of bean counter guy. And he sees all these people, and he's calculating how this would go. And Jesus knew he was already calculating. So he asked him, hey, what do you think? Philip's like, oh, this is too much money. We can't afford this. We'll never get this done. The other disciples, the other 10, say nothing. They're all like, Philip, you got this one, buddy. We're stepping back. You got it. You know, they say nothing. They're just spectators in this event. And Andrew comes to the rescue, and he brings Jesus a small boy. He brings Jesus a small boy. I wonder why the Gospels tell us it's a small boy. I wonder if it's because he spent his whole life in the shadow of big brother Peter. He knows what it's like to be like the leftover kid. And he brings this kid. God can do something amazing through. Here's my question. Did Andrew find the boy, or did the boy find Andrew? It doesn't tell us, but I speculate, because what I know about Andrew, that Andrew found the boy. We don't know for sure, but I think that, because he's the only one of the 12 disciples. In all the gospel stories, he's the only one who knows anything about the people in the crowd. And he's not the only one from Galilee. There are others from that town too. Remember, he's a connector. He connects people. He's out working the crowd. Jesus is doing his thing. Andrew's over here shaking hands. Hey, thank you. I'm glad you're here. You got to wait till you hear Jesus. He's great. You should sit over here. You get a better view. This is what Andrew's doing. He's working the crowd. He's a connector. He's getting to know people. He's finding their stories out. Who's here? Interesting that other times in the gospel, when little kids come to Jesus, the disciples, what do? They shoo them away. Get out of here. We got busier things happening. But yet, Andrew brings this young boy to Jesus because I think he believes Jesus can do something amazing, just perhaps. The point is partly this. Andrew, as a disciple, paid attention to the people in that crowd. He knew that Peter was looking for a Messiah. He had paid attention to his brother, brought him to Jesus, and he knew in this crowd that what the boy had for lunch. That's a fascinating thing to learn. As he's mingling the crowd, finds this little boy. Clearly, he probably stooped down, hey, show me what you got for lunch. And they're just kind of chatting. He got that information by connecting with people, knowing what's going on. Here's my point. We learn for this from Andrew. It's true for all disciples. Disciples aren't spectators. And the other 11 learned that day not to be spectators, but to be involved in people's lives. A mark of a disciple is knowing people, not just their name, but their lives. Church, know these people in this room and the people in Sunday school classes and the people who will be in here at our 11 o'clock hour and the people in our Haitian congregation, people in our Ethiopian. Know each other. It matters that you're not a spectator, that you're in each other's lives. Do you know today who's sick? Do you know today who's celebrating? Do you know today who's mourning? Now, you don't have to know everybody, but I believe it's a valuable thing for disciples to know the people that they're involved with. Don't be on the sidelines. Be in the game. Don't be a spectator. Be in there. His third story is from John chapter 12. It's an interesting story. Let me just walk this through to you, and then we'll get to some very specific things for disciples that I really want you to hear, maybe perhaps above all today. There were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew, and Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Now let's just look at that real quick. Philip and Andrew often kind of put together. There are Greeks at a Passover event. There are some non-Jewish people at a very, very Jewish thing. And before I tell you about that, can I talk real quick about a whole different thing? Let's talk about what happened in our nation this week. We're talking about immigration language. If you've heard this stuff, the president made some comments, or maybe he made them allegedly. I mean, I don't know. I wasn't in the room, and stuff has been flying all over the place about other cultures. And let me just say this. This story reminds us that everybody matters. Amen, church? Amen. Everybody matters. We as Christians believe that everybody is an equal child of God, whether you're from America or El Salvador or Zimbabwe or Jamaica or Haiti or anybody. Everybody's a child of God. Everybody should have equal access to the kingdom of God. Now, I don't understand all things of immigration. I don't get all that. That's beyond what I understand. I'm sure there are complications. But think about it in this way. In terms of the kingdom of God, in terms of what God's kingdom, what God thinks, every one of us is an immigrant into the kingdom of God. Nobody was born as a citizen of the kingdom of God. We all have sin. God has adopted us into his family. And it matters for us as Christians that we let other cultures know everybody matters. Amen, church? I don't know all the implications of this, but I know God cares for us all as children. And as Christians and Americans, we should be about that business. This is what happens. Some Greeks show up to a non-Greek thing. They're not Jewish. They come here. And what does Philip do? He's like, what are we going to do? They're outsiders. They're here. Do we let them in? Sound familiar? Do we let them in? And what does Andrew go? Let's go tell Jesus. Let's bring him to Jesus. That's what happens there. He's a connector. He's a bringer. I think this is why they come to Philip. Philip and Andrew both have Greek names. They sound Greek. So these other Greek guys thought, well, maybe they're outsiders. We can come in too. And that's what happens there, okay? And Philip and Andrew, they want to see Jesus. Good. That's a great thing. Good thing to want to see Jesus. Philip and Andrew gather. They have the first church committee meeting. What do? Do we let these people in? And Andrew says, sure, let's take them to Jesus. Absolutely. And then Jesus responds to this with a statement about himself and four things for disciples. This is what I want us to land on. Here's what he says about himself, okay? Next slide, please. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now, reading all between the lines here, Jesus welcomes them in. Absolutely, he totally does. This is Jesus predicting his death. when these two Greek people, these two outsiders in terms of like the religious language, when they come to see him, he's saying, they want to see me? Good. I want the whole world to see me, Jesus is saying. He says, you will see me. You will see me die, and you will see the Father raise me to life again. And that's how God will glorify me. He says, the time has come for me to be glorified because not only do Jews believe in me, but now the word is spreading. Now's the time. They want to see me? The whole world needs to see the glory of God through what I'm about to do, is what Jesus is saying. And everyone will worship him as the King of Kings. Greeks, Jews, everybody. Okay? Then he has four things to say about disciples. Are you ready for this? Let me tell you this first. Being a disciple is hard and it's awesome. And those two things are often linked together. This is not an easy thing we're called to do. It's a hard thing we're called to do. And Jesus is about ready to capitalize everything to Andrew. Four things that are very hard about being a disciple, but are also very rewarding. Here's what he says. Very truly, next slide please. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. We're called as Christians to die. This is hard. I know in some cultures, that's literally true, physically true. In our culture, it's just vastly different, and I think we don't have a full understanding of what that means because of where we live. If you're a Christian living in other countries where it's illegal to be a Christian, I think they understand this more so than we ever will. We die to ourselves, meaning we live a life of sacrifice. And fruit comes to that. Only when you sacrifice does fruit come in your life. That's the good things that happen. You want good fruit in your life. You want everlasting fruit. You want good results that honor God. It comes first through sacrifice. That is hard. Next thing he says here is, anyone who loves their life will lose it. We got it? While anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Again, it's hard to hate your life. Don't go crazy on that. Jesus doesn't mean like hate your family, hate your house, hate your job. That's not what that means. He means this. There's a way of life that the culture says this is the good life. What do we as Christians do? We abandon that life. We don't love that life, and we embrace the life that God has before us. That's the abandonment. There's certain things and activities and stuff that isn't becoming of a Christian, isn't part of the kingdom of God. We abandon that. Ways of thinking, ways of acting, and we embrace the kingdom of God, and that is hard to do. It is hard to do, which is why Jesus prayed a whole chapter, John 17, for us to be able to do that. But that's how we gain eternal life, pursuing the life of Jesus. Next one he says there, towards the bottom there, he says this, whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant will also be. If you want to be a disciple, you've got to go where Jesus would go and do what Jesus would do, and this is hard. This is hard. Because where does Jesus go? The cross. It's very hard. But if we follow him here in this life, if we follow Jesus wherever he goes in this life, then we will follow him straight into eternity. That's what it means to be a follower. And the last hard thing he says there is that very last line. My Father will honor the one who serves me. This is hard. It's hard serving. We like to be served. It's hard to be the waiter. We'd rather be at the table eating. It's hard to be the one doing the dishes. We'd rather be kicking our chair, feet up on the chair. It's hard to be the servant. It is difficult to be that, but this is how you're honored by God. Jesus raised God raised Jesus up from the dead. He will also raise us up to eternal life if we serve him. That's what it means to be a disciple. Let me wrap with this. Give me 90 seconds. The first thing Jesus says to Andrew is, come and see. And the last thing he says, we just read it, is now go and die. That's significant. That's significant. Here's what happened to Andrew. Let me show you this. This is the flag of Scotland. The flag of Scotland is called St. Andrew's Cross. This is the representative straight on of the cross that Andrew was crucified on. This is the flag of Scotland. This is what it is. It's not just a funky design somebody made. Here's what happened. Andrew takes the gospel to Russia and many other places, and he led many to faith in Rome. And one of the governors in the Roman area, Aegeus, asked the Roman Senate to require all Christians to sacrifice to idols, because he was getting really sick of Andrew, what Andrew was doing and teaching, and it was bad for the economy, and it was bad for him. And he went to the Senate and said, let's make it so that all of the Christians have to sacrifice to the gods. And Andrew came to Aegeus and said, we're not going to do that, because number one, the idols are evil, and number two, you're evil. Well, he just didn't like that at all. So they grabbed him and they said, you can't preach anymore. And he says, oh, I'm going to preach. Here's what he says, his exact quote that we have, we think through history. He says, I would have not preached the honor and glory of the cross if I feared the death of the cross. In other words, you want to crucify me? There's a good spot right now. Let's just go get it done. And so they do, they erect a cross. It's called the St. Andrew's cross. It's at an X. And they flayed him and spread him out, spread eagle, and crucified him, and he died. At some point, disciples, to be a devoted disciple of Jesus, you've got to transition from come and see who Jesus is to go and die for him. I know you're not going to be crucified, hopefully, but the mark of a disciple is sacrifice. We can't just watch other people walk with Jesus. We've got to walk with him. We can't just rely on everybody else to serve. We need to serve. We can't just rely on everybody else to fund ministry. We have to fund ministry. We can't rely on everybody else to lead our family to Jesus. We have to do it. We can't, at some point, the season of come and see who Jesus is and learn from him has got to stop. And you've got to be a go and die Christian who goes and serves and goes who loves. And you know what happens when you do? You're loved by God, you're honored by God, and you are a disciple. Amen, church? On your feet. Thank you, Jesus, so much for your love this day and for the story of Andrew and how he brought people to Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for the people that have brought us to you. And obviously, we pray that you use us to bring others to you, Jesus. I pray for us as disciples that we would, in fact, cease, if called be, to be Christians who just come and see what you're doing, to people who go and die, who live for you and serve you and sacrifice for you and lead for you. And we know that good things happen. We are honored by you. We are loved by you. And that then people know that we are your disciples. Help us to abandon anything that would keep us from doing that, Jesus. And I pray this week, Lord, that that would be at the forefront of our mind, that that's what Christians do. And Lord, in our nation right now, a lot of struggling language, a lot of struggling thoughts. Just pray that your grace and truth permeate our system and our leaders so that your truth would be elevated, your truth would be known, your truth would be proclaimed. Thank you, Jesus, for these people. Bless them all this week with your grace. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, have a wonderful day. I hope every one of you will, don't be a spectator, head to Sunday school, and may the peace of Jesus Christ be with you all. You're dismissed. Have a good day.
There's a wall that has been standing since the day that Adam fell. Sin is where it started. Sin is why it held. Speaking as a prisoner who was there and lived to tell, I remember how it felt. I could hear the sound of freedom like a distant voice had called and beckoned me to follow where I had never gone.
Check. Is the mic check? Check, check, check. All right, it's about to get loud in this room. All right, what do we need to go over? Cass, you man, what do we need to go over here? Anything particular, everything, or just a little bit of everything? Tell you what, let's do this. I forgot Mike's like catching up here. Do you got to go at some point? Whenever you need to. But what do you need to go over before? Is there anything specific you need to hit?